Hey, Jim. How you doing?
My son hates me.
No, I wouldn't say that. I just think he misses your old comedy roles.
Oh, yeah?
I think everyone does. You haven't been in a funny movie in over a decade now.
Last night at his birthday party, he made a wish.
Wait, let me guess. He wished that you would produce a sequel to one of your most beloved classics.
That's right!
Really? You went through with it? I thought you swore sequels off after you did When Nature Calls.
You don't believe me, do you?
Well, I don't know if it really matters if I believe you or not, because this is movie night! Hello and welcome to this special, partially unscripted episode of Movie Night. I'm your host, Jonathan Paula. Tonight, in honor of his most recent release, Dumb and Dumber 2, we'll be taking a look back at some of my favorite Jim Carrey comedy movies. His childish antics, loud voices, and funny faces may not be for everyone, but there's no denying that Jim Carrey is a talented individual who's contributed plenty of memorable characters over the years to cinema. Joining me for tonight's discussion is fellow YouTube film critic Adam Olinger of Feud Nation. Welcome to the show, Adam.
Thanks for having me on, John. It's a pleasure to be here. I apologize for the nasally voice. I'm getting over something, possibly Ebola. I am also disappointed Cable Guy's not on this list. It is one of Jim Carrey's superior films. Nevertheless, I didn't pick them. I'm only here to dispute them, maybe even agree with you from time to time.
And with that, let's begin this unique discussion-focused episode with Carrey's oldest comedy, Ace Ventura, Pet Detective. Tom Shadyk directed this 86-minute comedy film that became a cult hit after its February 4th release in 1994. Following a successful stint on the sketch comedy show In Living Color, Jim Carrey is featured as the lead for the first time in his career, and a role that would catapult him to Hollywood stardom. The $15 million film, co-written by Carrey, scored over $100 million at the box office. At a very quick 86 minutes, the PG-13 rated narrative follows Carrey as the titular hero, who sets off on a bizarre series of events to track down the Miami Dolphins' missing aquatic mascot.
And to carry us on this journey, we have a ragtag team of stars ranging from Courtney Cox, Tone Locke, Sean Young, and of course Dan Marino, playing Dan Marino.
I don't really agree with his inclusion in this film. I don't know about you, Adam, but it felt completely out of place. It would have been better if they just kept him to a small cameo capacity.
But it doesn't matter because Carrey steals every scene he's in anyways.
Absolutely, Carrey is fantastic every single time he opens his mouth, which isn't necessarily when he's speaking. There's a bunch of scenes where Ace Ventura just runs around moving his lips and chin, the overly complicated Sherlock-like exposition where he's opening and closing the balcony door while shouting at the top of his lungs still makes me laugh to this day.
He's not only a verbal comedian, if that's a thing, but he's also a very heavy physical comedian, much like Chris Farley. He's constantly jumping around, flailing his arms.
Are you sure your date is arrived? It's been an awfully long time.
Who, Tom? Oh, I'm sure he's fine.
Do not go in there! Woo!
Ace Ventura is extremely quotable. There are so many lines that I go back to over and over again. Laces out. Alrighty then. Let's see that again in instant slow-mo replay. How good is that? The only thing I don't like in Ace Ventura is when he talks out of his ass. I think it was juvenile then, and it's obviously juvenile now.
There's another shot of someone else's butt that I didn't need to see either, but that's a bit of a spoiler.
Ass-to-ass comparisons aside, it's still one of my favorite comedies to date.
I don't know if I would go that far, Adam, but it's definitely one of Jim Carrey's more iconic roles. But let's see what you had to say about it in the YouTube comments. A 10 from Adam, a 7 from the audience, as well as myself. The phrase most consistently used was that Jim carried the film, no pun intended, with his insane performance, which saved an otherwise lackluster script.
First off, I think that pun was intended. Secondly, 7 out of 10 is too low for this. This established Jim Carrey's career. There's a reason this guy at one point in life was getting $40 million a picture.
Well, I can see that you've made a strong argument, Adam, but still, I have to only rate this a cool. For tonight's poll question, an obvious one. What is your favorite Jim Carrey movie? Leave your response as a comment below. Tonight's second film, we're reviewing The Mask.
In July of 1994, this Chuck Russell action comedy fantasy film was hugely successful, reaching over 15 times its $23 million budget and scoring an Oscar nomination for visual effects. Based on a series of Dark Horse comics, the 101-minute story follows Jim Carrey as a pathetic bank clerk who discovers a mysterious mask with superpowers. Alongside him in this PG-13 rated movie is the smoking hot Cameron Diaz in her career-launching film debut as a sexy vixen love interest. She is smoking hot. Smoking!
I was hoping you were gonna launch into that impression, because that's really what sells The Mask for me, is all of Jim Carrey's one-liners. Is somebody stop me? He breaks into Dirty Harry, he does Bugs Bunny, he does Tasmanian Devil. An excuse for him to become a live-action cartoon character, and if that's what floats your boat, this movie, you know, sets sail for the high seas, because it's fantastic.
Let's rock this joint!
He also sings in this movie. He has the pineapple hat on, and he has the maracas. I can't remember the name of the song, but...
Cuban Pete. He manages to get the entire police force of Edge City to swing and dance and do the mambo while he distracts them and gets away. And besides being littered with all that up-tempo big band swing music from a variety of well-known artists, Randy Edelman also contributes a whimsical and lively score that excellently matches all the incredible fantasies on screen.
The mask only works when he has the damn thing on. When he is just his regular self, I'm almost falling asleep. Cameron Diaz certainly helps, because she is very easy on the eyes in this film. I cannot stress enough how hot Cameron Diaz is in this movie.
It's sort of unfair, honestly. Especially alongside the rest of the supporting cast, which includes Peter Greer, Richard Jenny, Peter Reigert, and Amy Yasbach. They all do an okay job, but really, it's the scenes with the mask opposite the hot, young Cameron Diaz that make this movie worth watching again and again.
Even though this movie didn't blow me away as much as it probably did you, John, I will say this. It is wholly unique. Not since Who Framed Roger Rabbit have I seen a movie go to such extreme lengths with the animation and the live action.
Absolutely. The animation and the visual effects here earned that Oscar nomination for a reason. Really, really ambitious, and they integrate into the live action stuff impeccably well. This entire thing was just a perfect vehicle for Carrey's manic, improvised humor, and I thought it was a great film. But let's see what you had to say about it in the YouTube comments.
There was mixed opinions on The Mask, but because of Jim Carrey's scene-stealing performance, it averaged out to an 8. I went a little bit lower with the 7. Nevertheless, let's move on to Dumb and Dumber.
The Farley brothers, Peter and Bobby, direct this quintessential road comedy movie that made over $230 million in profit when it was released in December of 1994. The 107-minute story follows Jim Carrey and Jeff Daniels as two good-natured but incredibly stupid friends who set out on a cross-country road trip and get mixed up with some curious characters and hilarious situations along the way. Thanks to the massive success of his earlier two films released in 1994, Carrey was finally able to command a sizable salary here, with his $7 million paycheck comprising almost half of this film's budget.
I think everybody expected Jim Carrey to knock it out of the park, and he of course does, but what we weren't expecting was Jeff Daniels to do such a damn fine job.
Especially whenever he's bouncing off Jim, the two of them have excellent chemistry on screen, and they have no problem dishing out all of the slapstick humor and verbal puns. Like when they get pulled over by a police officer and he says, "No, it's a cardigan, but thanks for asking."
I'm glad you brought him up. There's a lot of great supporting cast. They don't even have to necessarily say much of anything. They're just there and they're recognizable, such as the waitress. Excuse me, Flo? And then you have Seabass, of course.
Played by Boston Bruins hockey player Cam Neely, of all people.
Then there's the villains, Mike Starr being the prominent one who goes along with the road trip. He's particularly great because he's such a straight man why these two idiots are bouncing dialogue off him, and you can just tell he's gonna lose his freaking mind.
The movie's not afraid to play down to a juvenile crowd, however, with some ultimate potty humor. The scene where Daniels gets extreme diarrhea on a broken toilet remains one of the funniest scenes, I think, in all of movie history.
That, with Carrey driving back on his dumb little scooter with the Wizard of Oz theme song, the witch theme song playing, is just the icing on the cake.
Despite some of these childish moments, though, the PG-13 rated movie still has a fair number of effective emotional beats that really anchor the story.
Dumb and Dumber for me cemented the Farley brothers as a go-to comedic duo. On top of that, they set the scene for Carrey and Daniels to do a ton of improv, such as the barroom where Jim Carrey's leaving and he sees the man walks on the moon sign.
Then we also have the Pretty Woman makeover montage where they have the masseuses grinding down Carrey's gigantic, disgusting toenails.
Okay.
Excuse me, gentlemen. This is a $500 plate dinner. Good night.
Oh, $500. Oh, okay. All right, no problem. Here, put us down for four.
In case we want seconds.
I brought up the improv, but I also need to point out how this is the most quotable movie of all time.
Big gulps, huh? Well, see you later.
Those skis yours?
Hey, Adam, do you want to hear the most annoying sound in the world?
Our pets' heads are falling off!
Mock.
Yeah.
Ing.
Yeah.
Bird.
Yeah.
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 Well, that's just a taste of the excellent music this film has, thanks to its great pop rock soundtrack, which includes music from The Primitives, Crash Test Dummies, The Gigolo Aunts, and dozens more. It is a soundtrack I love listening to on repeat even to this day. Point being, this film is fantastic from top to bottom, with excellent rewatchability. I loved it as a kid, and I still do today. It might be childish as hell, but I love the hell out of it. And here's what you had to say about the comedy in the YouTube comments. Surprisingly, this is a very polarizing feature. Some people hated the movie, and others, like Adam and I, loved it. Your ratings averaged to an 8. What did you think, Adam?
That's a 10, John.
I agree. One of the funniest movies that I know of, I have to score this a 10 as well. Fourth up tonight, let's discuss Liar Liar.
This slapstick-heavy comedy by director Tom Shadyac was released in March 1997, where it grossed over $300 million against a $45 million budget. Following a fantastical wish by his young son, a fast-talking lawyer is unable to lie for a 24-hour period. Jim Carrey stars as the eccentric lead in this PG-13 rated narrative that includes supporting performances from Marie Turney, Justin Cooper, Cary Elwes, Amanda Donahue, and Jennifer Tilly.
While Carrey's character isn't as animated as eccentric as some of his other more iconic roles, he literally beats himself up for this one in a landmark sequence where he smashes his own head against a urinal repeatedly in an attempt to avoid going back into the courtroom.
That's just one of many sequences that stand out in this flick to me. Then there's the classic "the pen is blue" sequence, because Jim Carrey cannot tell a lie.
Hi.
Hi.
New in the building?
Yeah, I just moved in Monday.
Oh, you like it so far?
Mm-hmm. Everybody's been real nice.
Well, that's because you have big jugs. I mean, your boobs are huge. I mean, I want to squeeze them. Oh. Mama!
Another great example of this lawyer with a truth-telling curse is when he objects to the judge. Why? And he says, "'Cause it's devastating to my case!"
Not to mention, Cary Elwes is very scary. The claw. Here comes the claw.
It's gonna get ya! Why does he think it's a claw? He's just holding one finger. A claw is very clearly, by definition, a series of two or more fingers.
It's a hook. It's a hook, really.
Come on, Princess Bride, get your act together.
Then we have Jennifer, I've never been in a goddamn movie Adam can stand, Tilly, once again ruining every f***ing scene she's in.
Yeah, Tilly definitely earns her spot in the supporting cast department. Anyway, what I really like about Liar Liar is that it has a very unique, but simple concept. A lawyer that can't tell a lie for 24 hours. And Carrey knocks it out of the park with, again, another stellar performance. It's just too bad that this entire plot was sort of rehashed and revisited just a decade later with Yes Man, which was a far inferior follow-up.
Speaking of other films, John, had Jim Carrey not done Liar Liar, he would have played Dr. Evil in Austin Powers. Man, would that have been an entirely different film. I think it's interesting how this is probably one of Jim Carrey's only family films.
I would disagree. There's a scene in the courtroom where we just listen to Jennifer Tilly get banged by the pool boy for about 5 solid minutes.
Sex tapes. For kids.
It's anything but family friendly, Adam.
Maybe the word I should have said was watered down then, because this is definitely one of Jim Carrey's lighter roles, I'd say. From a technical standpoint, I don't think there's really a whole lot to write home about. I don't remember a single song from the film. I think it's all pretty ABC Family style.
With a manic performance laced with adult humor and a family friendly message, this is an interesting comedy worth watching at least a couple times, especially if you stay till the end credits with all those great bloopers thrown in for good measure. But that's what Adam and I thought about Liar Liar. Here's what you had to say about it in the YouTube comments.
I'm noticing a trend with these ratings, and ultimately I think it comes down to whether or not you like Jim Carrey. Those that did had favorable things to say, resulting in a great. Now, while the film is interesting, it is a bit run-of-the-mill for Jim Carrey. John and I are giving it a cool. Now let's move on with the final film of the night, Dumb and Dumber 2.
20 years after the original installment, the Farley brothers have reunited Jim Carrey and Jeff Daniels in this earnest, if completely unnecessary, sequel. The PG-13 rated adventure made back its $40 million production budget a week after its November 14th, 2014 release. The contrived 109-minute plot follows Carrey and Daniels on another bizarre road trip as they search for a long-lost daughter in need of a kidney.
Rob Riggle, Rachel Melvin, and Laurie Holden are the supporting cast. Then there's also Kathleen Turner. What happened? This movie was terrible. I'm sorry.
I thought it was okay. It seemed less to me like a cash grab and more like an honest attempt to make a sequel for the fans that loved the original. It by no means stacks up anywhere close, but I thought it was a decent attempt.
It's ridiculous that they thought that they could go back to the well 20 years later, when clearly the script is stuck 20 years ago.
And while I completely agree with all of that, I also sort of enjoyed the throwbacks to the original script. The fact that the movie felt like it was stuck in 1994 worked to its advantage. There were plenty of callbacks and references that felt very fan service oriented. But as a standalone picture, I don't think it quite lived up.
And that's the biggest understatement of all time. Jim Carrey and Jeff Daniels are caricatures of who they used to be. They are full-on cartoons.
Indeed, it's very weird to see the respected, dramatic, Emmy Award-winning actor Daniels pulling down his pants and showing his ass cheeks in every other scene. The work seems quite beneath him.
Pun unintentional that time, John, but very well done. Let's start at the beginning of the picture, though, because that's where the train wreck really starts. Here we see Lloyd Christmas 20 years later doing a practical joke on Harry that's, of course, ruined in the trailer, losing a lot of that funniness that it could have had. Is funniness, is that a word, John?
If you ask the Farley brothers, yes. If you're asking me, no, of course not. Buy a dictionary.
I guess the dumbness of the picture is running off on me. They have a joke that's not even funny to begin with, and it overstays its welcome.
There were a few sequences, especially towards the end, that really hit with some good, hearty chuckles, especially a sequence where Daniels is judging people's school projects. One kid cures cancer, and he's just like, nah, it's not good enough.
I totally disagree. I thought the last third of the movie was just off the rails bad. Not a single joke landed. The pacing was all over the place. It's like the Farley brothers forgot how to set up a shot, how to follow through with the comedic timing, and how to have an actual punchline.
You guys want to play He Who Smelt It?
Huh? What's that?
It's complicated, so pay attention. We put the windows up. First one who smells a fart gets a point. If you say who dealt it, double points.
But if you say you smelled a fart and nobody farted, like if we were just passing a slaughterhouse,
false fart,
you lose a point. And you can't smell your own farts either.
What, are you guys kidding? No. No. I'm not going to sit around sniffing your guys' farts like some kind of truffle pig. Forget it.
Okay, fine. Lloyd and I will play one-on-one.
Yeah, head-to-head.
How can you play one-on-one? If you smell a fart and you didn't do it, isn't it obvious the other guy did?
I thought you said you never played before.
The bar is set so high, it needs to hit that level, or at least get close, and it did not. Maybe it was just me, but they seemed very mean-spirited. There was a lot of negativity towards them,
I'm glad you said that, Adam, because I think the thing that's missing most from this film is the emotional core of Dumb and Dumber 1. It had those beats where we really felt for these characters. They were pathetic, they were dumb, and they were losers. But they were aware of it and were trying to better themselves. This movie, they were just sort of assholes that jerked around all day and didn't do anything with themselves. And the very end of the movie has this big twist I'm not going to spoil, but it sort of undercuts everything that came before it.
I spent the last couple minutes bitching to no end about this sequel, and I stand by everything I said. It should have been much more. There was 6 writers attached to this movie. 6 of them. Where were the jokes? I'll tell you where. In the theater. In the audience. Joke was on us. This is a 3. It's lame.
I'm not going to be that harsh on it, but this was definitely a meh experience. Now here's what you had to say about other films currently playing in theaters with some of your tweet critiques. If you see a new movie in theaters, tweet your review with the JPMN hashtag to be featured on the show. And before we go, thank you again to Adam Olinger from Feud Nation for being part of tonight's discussion on Jim Carrey films. It was a spirited debate on some of our 5 favorites. Adam, thanks for being on the show. Appreciate it.
Thanks for having me, John, and it's great to see you again. He was just on my show a couple weeks ago doing Interstellar versus Inception. If you like the idea of 2 movies going head-to-head, come on over to Feud Nation. I'd love to have you subscribe and engage in conversation. I do a lot of these things at least once a week, so I'd love to see you come by.
If you'd like to watch more episodes of Movie Night or Movie Feuds, check out the links on the right or click subscribe to be notified of all new content. And don't forget to follow me on Twitter, Facebook, Google+, Instagram, or Letterboxd for updates between episodes. As always, my name is Jonathan Paula. Thank you for watching and listening. Until next time, have a good movie night.